Now came in 1904, we had an Indian University Act. According to this act, the first provision of this act was the governing bodies of the universities were to be constituted, and very important, Senate, the size of those committees should be reduced. Earlier it was n number of people, but it has to be minimum 50 people and maximum 100 people according to the Indian Universities Act. First of, and another is like these, you know, these senates, they would hold the office only for 6 years. That means they will be renewed after every 6 years. For the universities of Mumbai, Calcutta and Madras, the elected fellows were to be 50 because they are big universities, and the rest will be around 15 depending on the size of the universities where they are. The Governor General was now empowered to decide a university's territorial limits and also the affiliation between the universities and the college. Means the whole power now lied in the hands of the Governor General. Which university has what status, that will be decided by the Governor General. The Universities Act made the universities and college completely under the government control. And the last is that for better education and research, a grant of rupees 5 per year was given for 5 years. An amount was fixed that every year you will get 5 lakh rupees for consecutive 5 years. And this was the beginning of university grants in India, UGC, University Grant Commission. This was the base of that. And later on, I mean, it became a permanent structure in the Indian education system, very important. What kinds of education did you get during the British period? That is also a very important thing. First of all, you got collegial education. Private colleges needed larger financial assistance in order to have higher standard and to provide libraries, laboratories and hostels. So they wanted, gave education to the students so that they could have better people for libraries or laboratories or, you know, maintaining the hostels. Women education was also given importance. In the field of education of women, certain appointments were done in case of suitable teachers, good teachers for them, good organization of model schools were there, and some large funds were allocated to these education system. Moral education was also given a lot of importance, and there are many government institutes which were believed to be, you know, completely secular, like they will not teach any religion related education. Like earlier we had like madrasas and we have pathshalas. After that, we have some technical kind of education because they wanted some people, they needed people for some technical manpower for Indian markets. So they started to develop a technical courses for the students in the country. Earlier, we did not have any kind of educational, agricultural education in India. But now the reforms were suggested basically to establish an imperial agricultural college under the supervision of the Inspector General of Agricultural Sciences. Very important development during this period was this. Earlier, no incentive or no initiative was taken basically to lay importance on this. After that, in 1917, government appointed Calcutta University Commission, and it is also known as Sadler Commission with the, you know, name of the Sadler. He was the Vice Chancellor of the Leeds University in England, and he was appointed as the chairperson of this committee. He did some recommendations, like the first, we can say, the main objective of the commission was to inquire into the condition and prospects of the University of Calcutta. There was lots of problem in the Calcutta University in terms of management and other things. So this was appointed for taking care of this basically. the commission discussed the main weakness that they have in the higher education system in Bengal, and then it offered some kind of recommendations, like what should be done. So the first thing that should be done was all the teaching resources in the Calcutta should be organized. Earlier, as I said, a lot of confusion, not organized and all that. So it was to be organized entirely a teaching university. It meant that all the colleges in Calcutta should be grouped together, and they will be, you know, discharge the same functions of teaching university. They will act like a university. After Kolkata, they wanted to have a separate teaching and residential university at Dhaka. This was a time when East Bengal and Pakistan were a part of India. So in Dhaka, they wanted to have another university there. They wanted to have other universities, to establish there, and older ones were also there for teaching and the residential purpose. And their main aim was to, turn into universities, to become universities. So first that will be, they will act like a college, and after that, after some time, they will become university. So that was their main motive. These universities should be free from the excessive official control. Officers should not interfere in the academic matter of the university. Very important, because we see that there is a lot of interference by the government and other authorities there. So that he did not want to do that. And academic council should be established too in the universities, which should deal with all the academic questions that students have, like, what should be the course I should take, how will be the examination, or how can I get a degree, what is the research process. So certain steps were, measures were taken to take care of that. After that, for the first time, a full-time salaried vice chancellor should be employed. This is what he suggested was, so that he can take care of the administration of the university. The next recommendation by this committee was, we should have some separate faculties or the board of studies and other saturated bodies the universities. That means we should have some faculties which should serve as the department of teaching, like in universities we have different departments, like mathematics department and computer science and history department, like that. Then committee also recommended that we should have honors courses along with pass courses. Pehle universities mein sirf pass courses hote the, but there was no honor courses. So this university is recommended for honor courses also. Then it also suggested that we should have tutorials and some superior kind of research work in the universities. The university should organize these courses for the students. Then there were some provisions which were also made for the instruction in different technical fields, you can say, like engineering or like medicine, law, agriculture, and some kind of other technologies. Basically, earlier no importance was given to these kind of courses, but now the universities also were asked to cover some practical and vocational studies, as well as technical and in industrial courses, so that Britishers can get a lot of people for industries and workers. Next was, they realized that there is a need of a coordinating agencies. So far, a lot of universities were established in Bombay, Kolkata, Chennai, and Madras and other places. But there was a need for coordinating agency, so they decided to have an inter-university board that can coordinate among these universities. By the time we have 1912, 1921 and 22, at that time the financial position of the primary education, it changed a lot. The colonial government, you know, they you can say like 50% of yen means half of the total cost of education that was borne by the government. That means the government started bearing more than half of the expenditure spent on the primary education. And the percentage by the local people declined, it fell down. But despite so many efforts by the government, by 1917, only 1/4 of the total number of boys went to school. Only 1/4. So you can understand what was the difference. And the main reason for the neglect of the primary education for many years was English education. Because these people, the government, they wanted to have the people for basically for government jobs. So they wanted to train them in English education, but the common people were not ready to accept those things or go for, you know, English education. Then in 1919, we have a Government of India Act was passed by the Britishers. Basically, for the purpose of Montague and Chelmsford. Montague and Chelmsford were two people. They recommended some things for India. So at that time, during this time, mainly diarchy in the provinces was introduced. Diarchy, like you can say, they divided the things in between the center and the provinces. So this is called Dai. Dai means two and archy is rule. So diarchy is where they divided the power in basically two powers, like center and provinces. So some things like some departments like education, health, agriculture and some local bodies, they were transferred to the ministers responsible to the provincial legislature. This was done, this was the main thing that happened in the Mont-ford reform. Now Mont-ford reform, you know, they suggested certain things, they recommended certain things like the provincial legislative assemblies, they had to fulfill, the demands regarding the grant in aid for the education institute. They were responsible for the education among the masses, the common people. That was the responsibility of the provincial legislative assemblies. Then by the time 1919, the national movement had started in India. So under the influence of the national movement, the provincial education was, you know, influenced, and they passed a bill saying that, you know, we should have elementary education free and compulsory in different provinces. Tab tak 1919 Mahatma Gandhi had come, 1915. So this time was really influenced, and it was the starting of the national movement in India. So these provincial governments, they really got influenced with that and emphasized on the elementary education for free and compulsory. After that, there was a need was realized for the coordination agencies both between the center and the provincial governments so that they don't have any miscommunication or something. So in that case, the Central Advisory Board of Education, CABE, very important, Central Advisory Board of Education, was established at different centers in 1921. Now, what was the main function of this board? The chief function of the board basically was to offer expert advice on important educational matters. So if any institution or if any organization or if any person, they wanted some kind of an advice, so this their work was to offer these expert advice. But board was abolished. It was abolished within 2 years because of the interest of the economy. Means government said that we don't have money, we are out, you know, in crisis, gave an excuse, and they abolished this within 2 years. But it was revived again in 1935, according to the Hartog Committee. So Hartog Committee again advised or recommended for the revival of this committee, that is CABE, and it was revived again in 1935. Now, what is, you know, Hartog Committee? Very important thing, very important thing we should know, because we just read that, you know, under the rule, under the recommendation, CABE was again appointed. On November 8, 1927, British government announced the appointment of Simon Commission. Simon Commission, very similar name, you know, like they had was a slogan, Simon Commission, go back. Same. So it was appointed, and it was asked to, you know, find out a report about the working of the Montague-Chelmsford reform. These are the pictures of Montague and Chelmsford. There were two people, they recommended these. So this committee, Simon Commission, was appointed to look into the matter. How about the education system? So Simon Commission further, you know, they appointed a helping committee under the leadership of Mr. Harlog. So Simon Commission gave the responsibility to Mr. Harlog to, you know, find out the state of education in India. So Harlog Committee, it submitted its report in 1929 to the government, and again it did some recommendations. And the recommendations that it mentioned was as follows. He said that, you know, we should have some committees. There should be committees which should work for the socially disadvantaged, you know, people. There is a need for them. They should, these committees should, you know, organize these communities, and they should be enlightened. They should be awakened, basically, to realize how important the education is. He said that it mentioned in that committee that out of every 100 boys which were admitted in class first in 1922 to 23, only 19 were found studying in class fourth in 25 and 26. Means there was a dropout of around 81 boys in the from class first to class fourth. So he had a lot of concern about it. It expressed a concern regarding wastage and stagnation which was there in the education system. Wastage in the sense like this fall. This is a wastage of students and time and money. So this committee also, you know, gave reasons why it all happened. What are the reasons for this wastage and this? First of all, the reason is absence of systematic organization of adult education. We don't have any adult education. So this was what it recommended to the committee. Difficulty in providing education in the schools below the population of 500. So there were no schools in the villages which were below 500 population. There was uneven distribution of the schools and inadequate use of the existing schools. Means somewhere there were many schools, but somewhere there were no schools. And whichever schools, existing schools were there, not were not enough, that were not, you know, adequate. There was a shortage of separate boys and girls schools, or you can say like schools on different communities or religion backgrounds. At that time in India, people had a lot of, emphasization on the caste system and their religion and all that. So they did not want to study together. People from different castes or different grades did not want to sit together. So they wanted separate schools. And there were no separate schools for boys and girls because the education difference was there. So then also there was a dropout in this ratio. Ineffective teaching and unsuitable curricula was another important factor that influenced the education system. And he believed that They also have some kind of inadequate inspecting staff. They should have some staff which should investigate on the teaching pattern or what curricula they follow, but they were not enough. And there were some unsatisfactory provisions for the compulsory primary education by the provincial government. He believed that provincial government is not paying a lot of emphasis on the education. According to the committee, the progress of literacy was slow due to many reasons, like it is because of the poverty of the people. They are poor, they don't want to send their children to the school, they are ignorant, they don't have knowledge, and lack of means of transportation, because in India, even now, there are many places that they don't have a proper transportation system for the children to go to school. Many seasonal diseases, which are there, people get affected, they don't go. Caste barriers, we just talked about it. Conservation, they are conservist, they don't want to send their children or girls to the school. And in some villages, the children are working in the fields. So there was a lot of importance which was laid on the primary and the education system by Horlock Commission. He was really concerned about the degrading education system under the British rule in India. The Horlock Committee made following recommendations, you know, to solve the issue of the primary education mainly. First of all, he suggested that minimum duration of primary education should be 4 years, compulsory 4 years. Second, he believed that the standard of the general primary teacher should be improved. It should be raised. How can we raise it? We can raise it by training and some kind of refresher courses or some kind of educational conferences, so that they are up to the mark, they know what to do, what to deliver and all that. And he also believed that the service and the salary should be improved. They should get better services, better salaries for what they do. Another point of importance for him was curriculum. Like we talked about, the problem was curriculum with the studies. He wanted to have a curriculum for the primary students to be very liberal, easy and suitable according to their local requirements. And the last, like here, is like teaching hours. Teaching hours in the schools and the holidays should be adjusted to the seasons and the local needs. Like, I'll share an example here. Like, for example, I know someone who lives in, usually in India, mostly like in North India, like in Delhi or Mumbai, we have summer vacations. But there are many areas in India which has a lot of rainfalls, like in the Northeast. So they have vacations, not in summers, but during the rainy seasons. And in winters, like hill stations, like Kashmir, Himachal, Uttarakhand, they have vacations, longer vacations during the winter season when there is a lot of snowfall. So the same thing, like, you know, they should adjust their holidays on the basis of their season and the local needs. So this was also a very important recommendation by Horlock Commission. He also believed that special attention should be paid to the lowest class in the primary school. Like the lower class, like the kindergarten or you can say first and all that, to check the wastage and stagnation. Children should come. They should not waste on their energy out there. The work of rural upliftment should be associated with the school work. They believed that the work of the development of the villages should be done along with the school work. If the villages are educated, they are upgraded, they know the importance of education, the government inspection staff should be increased. That was also one of the important recommendation of Horlock Commission. And he also believed that the courses in the middle schools should be made more diversified. Diversified means they should have a clear idea what to do. That means their main aim was to, you know, prepare the boys for the industrial and the commercial careers. Right in the middle school, they should decide what they have to do and how they should go about it in their future. After the implementation of the Horlock Commission recommendation, elementary education number in the primary school it increased. It rose from 1,55,016 people in 1921 to 22 to 1,92,000 in 1935. So this was an increase because of his recommendation. And the government also increased the expenditure on the education from, you can say, 3 crores 94 lakh 69,080 rupees in 1921 to 22 to 8 crores 13 lakh 38,015 rupees in 1937. Despite these kind of analysis and recommendation by the Harlow Commission for the improvement of primary education, not much progress was made during the next decade. Many reasons were responsible, and like, you know, poverty was one of the reasons. Class related barriers were there, which could not be overcome with due course of time. But because of this, there was a drawback in the education system. The CABE, which was dissolved in 1923 because of the financial reasons, which was again reorganized as per the recommendations of Harlow Commission, and its first annual meeting was held in December 1935, which recommended three stages of education in India. Primary stage, then we have is lower secondary stage, and we have is higher secondary stage. Primary stage should have a minimum of general education and ensure permanent literacy. Means minimum education should be provided to the children in the primary stage. The lower secondary stage is like, it has a self-sufficient curriculum for general education, on the basis of which the higher secondary education or the vocational training dependent. Like, basically you can say, like, now we have in India, like, we have a kind of a primary education, and after that we have is a secondary education, after that now we have is like senior secondary education. So something on the similar pattern was worked out in this part. Like, this was the lower secondary, and this was the higher secondary. So in the higher secondary stage, they believe that they should include some institutions with some specific courses depending on the need of the individuals, which was decided by the Harlow Commission. Then CABE requested the government to, you know, invite the advice of some experts for the construction or the recognition of the scheme. So two experts, that is Mr. A. Abbott and S. H. Woods, were appointed. They were asked to submit a report. They submitted a report in 1937, and this is known as Woods and Abbott report. They suggested, like, first of all, provision of trained teachers should be made to the primary school. Very important. If you have good and educated trained teachers, you have a better result. So they suggested, you know, that we should have good trained teachers in the primary schools. Special attention should be paid to the education of girls. This was also suggested by Woods and Abbott again. They also said that we need to bring change in the curriculum of the elementary education on the basis of the activities of the children than the bookish. Means more emphasis should be paid on the practical activities or practical usage rather than the bookish knowledge of that. They also recommended that education should be given in the mother tongue of the children, because that will be easier for them to understand rather than learning a new foreign language. Even though the elementary education was revived, but still there was some need to pay some kind of an attention during the 20th century, because there were not sufficient resources for this. So to desire to achieve a desirable goal, we needed some kind of extra resources for the development of education. Various committees during this period recommended different changes in case of curriculum, or maybe improving the teacher's skills, or regulating the standards of the school, or educating the children in their mother tongue, giving more resources, more funds to the schools. But the government, basically the colonial government or the British government, did not, you know, show the real interest in, you know, implementing these recommendations, because the main motive was to, what should I say, get the political interest, political profits, rather than, you know, spending money on the committees they had. So they paid interest, they gave emphasis on the education system, they made a lot of committees, they got the recommendations from them, but nothing was actually done, or I'll say not nothing, but not too much was done or worked on these kind of committees and recommendations during this pre-independence period or during the British period. Then we can talk about the period from 1935 to independence. India got independence in 1947. So during this period, especially in August 1935, the Government of India Act was passed, which took nearly 8 years. It was like Salmon Commission was appointed basically to give recommendations, which gave recommendations in 1927 to the government, and the law was made in 1935 on these recommendations. By that time, we know that the nationalism had started. So Mahatma Gandhi, he suggested a scheme of universal compulsory education for all the children in the age group of 6 to 13 years through the medium of their language, mother tongue. And also some kind of vocational training should be imparted in case of school education. So during the Salmon Commission, these recommendations were given by Mahatma Gandhi that they should have universal compulsory, universal means everyone equal compulsory education from 6 to 13 years of age, along with some vocational training so that they can have a career after that. In 1939, I'm talking about the colonial government, it participated in the Second World War, and thus these expansions, what was, you know, decided or recommended here, were not implemented basically. So in case of post-war reconstruction, like the World War was 1939 to 1945. So now we reach 1945. During this period, another committee was established under the leadership of Sargent. So that is known as Sargent Plan. It submitted its report to CABE. The plan aimed at training, the aim of, or the recommendations of this committee was mainly to give or attain the education standard of the contemporary England within minimum period of 14 years. Basically, they wanted to implement English as a medium of education in India so that they follow the English or the England process, English system. The important education's recommendations that were done by this committee was a reasonable provision for elementary pre-primary education for children between 3 to 6, which we call as elementary education, that was also given. They believe that, you know, nearly 10 lakh children will get admission in the nursery schools. Provision of universal means for everyone, compulsory means compulsory, mandatory for everyone, and free primary education will be given from age group 6 to 14. So 3 to 6 we have is nursery schools, then we have 6 to 14 is your primary schools. Full provision for training of teacher was also suggested in this, that they should have training. So they believe that, you know, they require around 22,17,733 teacher, a kind of an undergraduate teachers, you can say, or a non-graduate teachers for pre-primary stage, 33,300 for pre-primary stage, 11,96,200 for the junior basic stage, 6,25,560 for senior basic stage, and 81,320 for junior departments of the high school. These were all undergraduate or non-graduate teachers that they required. Apart from that, they also required 1,81,320 graduate teachers for senior departments. Like, for example, the junior teachers we call now is TGT, and the senior we call as PGT teachers. So same way, you know, this for senior schools and for the primary or the elementary schools. It was basically a plan which was suggested to solve the educational problem in the country, and universal, free and compulsory elementary education was the main motive. Despite that, you know, the all these efforts, the elementary education was ignored. Not much of importance was given, and it took another 50 years or more after independence basically to make this elementary education as an important fundamental right. So even this right of universal free elementary education was not included in our constitution at the time of independence. It took nearly 50 more years after the independence to get this right, this education right, fundamental for all children in India.